Welcome, and thank you for joining us for the University of Washington Library's biennial Anne Gould Hauberg Artist Images presentation to celebrate the work and impact of artist Marianne Peters through this interview with Mary Bruno. Marianne is a Seattle-based artist with an impressive body of work over the decades, and we're so proud to claim her as an alumnus, having received her MFA in painting and drawing from the University of Washington in 1977. Her career spans over 40 years, and her work has been exhibited internationally as well as throughout the United States. From her beginnings in Los Angeles, she's traveled to Mexico City, to Paris, Beirut, and Damascus in pursuit of her artistic vision. Her work is in collections, including the Henry Art Gallery, the Seattle Art Museum, and the Frye Art Museum. She's also produced public installations for the University of Texas, the Port of Seattle, and Sound Transit. A full list of her awards and recognitions would take way too long, so I'll mention just a few highlights. She was awarded the McLaughlin Foundation Fellowship at the Headland Center for the Arts, as well as the Arts Trust Visual Art Fellowship, the Camargo Fellowship in Cauce, France, and the Beirut Art Residency in Beirut, Lebanon. Marianne is also known for her art activism, serving on numerous boards, committees, and public forums on First Amendment rights and the arts. Her work is research-driven, employing painting, drawing, sculpture, and installation that addresses socially aligned topics. And as a second-generation Arab American, her work explores ways of understanding dismissed or undermined diaspora narratives, which we'll get to hear more about in this interview. I'm also pleased to introduce our interviewer, Mary Bruno, an aquatic ecologist, author, and veteran journalist, now working on a book about aquifers and inner lives. She's covered science and the arts for a variety of publications, including Newsweek, the Seattle Weekly, abcnews.com, and grist.org. Her 2012 environmental memoir, An American River, From Paradise to Superfund, Afloat on New Jersey's Passaic, has been made into an award-winning documentary. She has also known Marianne since the mid-1980s, and we're in a wonderful conversation about her long career in the arts. As a community that values exploration and discovery through collaboration, our university is dedicated to celebrating art that brings these values to life. The Art Images presentation is an opportunity for both the artist and the observer to discover, reflect, and grow together. And it's a recognition of how the arts benefit us as humans, emotionally, mentally, and even financially. And as a supporter of the arts, Anne Gould Hauberg appreciated this. So I'm going to close with her words. My hope for you and for myself is that our lives are filled with purpose and filled with content, expressed with skill and energy, and most of all, that our contributions endure in the memories of those whose lives we touch. In that spirit, I'm pleased to turn this event over to Mary Bruno and Marianne Peters.
Marianne, you're a second-generation Lebanese-American.
That's right.
And that family history, that family connection to the Mideast would figure very largely in your work eventually. But before we get there, let's talk a little bit about just your family and your childhood, and how did you decide to study art?
My family, the majority of my family is actually in the South. I was born in Texas, and my parents were raised in Texas. And when I was 5 years old, my father moved to Los Angeles, and so I grew up in Los Angeles. I just was the kid in the class that could draw and make things, and as I kind of progressed through grade school and high school and could see that that was possibly something that I could use, I started fantasizing about being an artist, but I had no idea what that meant. My family, yes, they are Lebanese, the ground floor of all my thinking. And it's because I grew up in a really convivial family and one whose love of their culture was pretty much tied around just camaraderie and food and nostalgia of the old country, which truthfully very few of us really knew how much that had figured into our family lore.
Why did they leave? Why did they come to the U.S.?
They left because when my grandfather was a teenager, the Ottoman Empire at the time, the Ottoman Syria Empire, was conscripting young boys to fight in their skirmishes. And at the time, there were several. And so my grandfather's family sent him to the Americas. On my mother's side, I know that my grandfather went through multiple countries to ultimately get to the United States. I don't know much about my father's story. I have a little bit of information, and I've made artwork about it, but I don't know his exact story. But it had to do with fighting in the military that they didn't want their sons to be a part of.
So how did you decide to apply to the University of Washington for their MFA program?
Well, it was going to be social services or art. My husband and I were running a group home for very young kids, 5 to 11 years old, in Santa Barbara. We sort of took turns getting jobs. It was at a time when you could take turns getting a job, and I found this job. And it proved to be definitely the opening for him to go into social services, but not for me. And I started thinking about wanting to go to graduate school. I didn't have the training, truthfully, to go to any kind of sophisticated art school, I didn't think. My skills were in drawing, mainly. I had never painted. I'd never built anything. So I had to kind of go with my inclination towards drawing, and that's how I applied to graduate school, was on drawings.
So you get into the MFA program at the University of Washington, and this is like 1975, right?
Right.
And you're here from 75 to 77. And it's a very heady atmosphere because your mentors are people like Michael Spafford and Jacob Lawrence. Your colleagues, the other students, are people like who have gone on like you to have very successful and amazing careers. Nancy Mee, Dennis Evans, Jeffrey Bishop, Carl Chu. So talk a little bit about how those people and this place and that time, that era, shaped your early work.
Well, when I went to graduate school at the University of Washington, most of the energy came from the other students. So I relied very much on my peers to kind of get me into the game of what it meant to be in graduate school. I did have a mentorship under Michael Spafford. I was his TA. And I'd have to say that working with him was kind of the most significant exchange I had, because he was so perfectly irreverent and brilliant in his irreverence. He was blunt. He would tell me that something was working or it wasn't working, and I felt like that's what I needed. And then my peers, right out of graduate school, there was a group of artists that you just mentioned, including Nori Sato and a professor, Bill Ritchie, who had started a studio. It was called Triangle Studios. And they recruited me to be in their studio. That was the beginning of really understanding what it means to be an artist, was being around them. They were ahead of me in school, most of them, and they had already started their careers. And so I was able to kind of be a fly on the wall of watching their maturation as artists as well. But they were also really adventuresome. They were making videos. Nori Sato and Carl Chu and Bill Ritchie were totally on the ground floor of what we understand to be video work in the country and in the nation, probably internationally now. Mm-hmm. And I personally didn't use those mediums, but to be around people who were thinking in that direction was certainly influential.
So what was the art world like then?
Well, there were certainly conceptual constraints that artists had to be at least aware of. And in my years as a graduate student, most of the thinking was confined to what I would say is minimal or conceptual work. So that is clearly not my personality now, but at the time it was the way that I actually learned how to compose images, to think about what the parameters of a topic might be. That was what was worthwhile about it. In Seattle, there were a few good galleries that most people were using that I was around. And I, in my second year of graduate school, went to Linda Ferris, who had one of the most important galleries at the time, and probably some would say historically. And I just asked her if I could work for her for free. That I felt like if I was going to work within the commercial art world, I needed to understand what that meant. Mm-hmm. And so I did. I worked for her. And then at the end of my tenure as a graduate student, she asked to see my work and gave me a show, which my first exhibition was with her in 1977.
So when I met you, and this was almost 10 years later in 1986, I remember there was this time when your work was described. Well, you were a painter, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, so a painter, mostly abstract subjects, although there would always be some sort of representational iconography in there somewhere. And your paintings are sort of often described, or your work is often described as very beautiful. Which it totally is and totally was. It was so lyrical, the colors were fantastic, just the way it flowed, it almost was like musical. But somehow or other, the idea, that adjective beautiful was sort of not really a compliment. It was almost like it's too beautiful. And I remember thinking at the time as a very unschooled art observer, how can beautiful be bad, right?
Right.
And so can you talk about that a little bit? About that being beautiful, being the beautiful artist, and what that meant.
I suppose it was a distraction from what somebody might consider to be a more important topic. And those were criticisms I was given when I was in graduate school, is that my work was too beautiful. And I didn't actually understand what that meant, except for I knew that it was a liability. And so I had to, I'd have to say I honed my willingness to be streamlined into these particular conceptual frameworks and learned from it. But then once I was on my own, I could start to refer to things that were always very influential to me. I've always had more of an affection for non-Western cultural and aesthetic considerations than Western ones. I was an exchange student in Pakistan when I was in college. You know, I came from this Arab American family. So once on my own, then I could start playing more directly with the idea of beauty.
Yeah, and we're going to get back to that, because I always think like sort of the aspect of your work that I find so compelling that was criticized as too beautiful. So we'll get to that in a little bit. So in 1990, you were invited to contribute a piece to the Goodwill Games.
Yes.
And the piece was called Akbar's Muse.
Exactly.
And I want you to talk about that piece, because it seems to me that and a piece that you did then 2 years later for the Bellevue Art Museum called Find the Syrian Boys, mm-hmm. was a moment, a detour that you took, a departure for you. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about those two pieces?
Sure. The Goodwill Games invitation was at 911 Media Arts Center that was in downtown Seattle. And the curator knew that I had been discussing all the influences of my work and that I wanted to work in a more sculptural way, but had not been given the opportunity to do it. So she gave me this chance. What I ended up doing was honing in, and I'm using that word again, but it seems to fit, on a site that I had seen in Pakistan or Afghanistan. There was an emperor, a leader named Akbar, who had this very universal notion of how governance should happen. And it should be that you follow all your advisors. So he built a site called Fata Per Sikri that you would walk into the room, and in the middle was like a wagon wheel on its end. And he would sit in the middle of the wagon wheel, and there were religious and I think also governing influences that he would talk to and ask them questions. So I took that story and tried to in some way convey how one maintains cultural attachments but also keeps an eye out for what else can happen. My choice was I went to the OK Hotel, which is no longer in existence in downtown Seattle, and took the doors from the hotel and suspended them in the room over a landscape that was made from spices. Mm. And those spices were in the color coding of how we determined race in this country: red, yellow, white, brown, and black. And the spices corresponded to those colors. So, and then it was dedicated in some ways to my father, and a letter that he had received from his father when he went away to college.
And now we're moving into Find the Syrian Boys.
And then Find the Syrian Boys was an invitation from the Bellevue Art Museum that I found this letter when my father passed away. My brother and sister and I found, like everybody does, things that you don't expect. And there was a letter from my father's father that praised him for being able to go away to Yale, which he had done. And at the end of the letter, he says, "I know it's really difficult, but if you can, please find the Syrian boys." So I made an homage to my father again and his cultural concerns and interests and loves. That was a room that was frescoed in the color of the dirt from where my father came from and from the dirt in Paris, Texas, which is a red dirt. And I rigged behind the walls a water system with the ability for the walls to weep. So at intervals, the walls would weep with an association to family names. My father's name was Shafi, but everybody called him Pete. And my family name would be Butras, only it's anglicized. So it means House of Peter, Peters, and that's the way it happened. And so I just, for an instant, tried to give back to my family, their origins in this piece, and to acknowledge how difficult it is to really maintain your cultural ties in a multicultural country.
Yeah. So what happened in that after the Find the Syrian Boys piece?
Oh, I just kind of dropped out of the commercial art world for a little while and honed my skills, and also got public art projects at that time.
Why did you come back to it? Because you eventually did.
Yeah, I eventually did.
Well, let me interject something there, because in the interim and in the wake of the Find the Syrian Boys piece, also 9/11 happened.
I was in San Antonio doing a public art project that was integrated into the architecture of a new building focused on Tomas Rivera. Tomas Rivera was a beloved scholar and activist and ultimately the first Mexican-American chancellor of a major university in the country. And my project focused on one of his books. It was a novel called And the Earth Did Not Swallow Him. San Antonio is surrounded by military bases. It also has a very culturally diverse and particularly towards Latin cultures. And I was trying to be respectful of a narrative that, while it was not my own, it was kindred to my own families. And so it was a big learning curve to be generous of spirit about a time that all of us were kind of shaken by.
And you were also making this work in public, right?
I mean, I was.
Like, you would go in every day and create this work as students were coming and going. And
yes, there was a conversation with the students who had no idea who Tomas Rivera was. And I was talking to students who were first generation college goers. They actually did not realize that they were able to go to college because of his efforts as an activist and a scholar. And it became very clear to me that if you wanted to make work that had some sort of cultural resonance, and I mean that in specifics of places and territory, that you needed the story. You needed to include a story so that there was a point of entrance for a viewer. And that really stuck with me and is influential in my work today.
So that Tomas Rivera piece, San Antonio, being there on 9/11, that it sounds, seems to me like it kind of, it sparked something. Then you subsequently traveled to Syria with your brother and sister, right? Visited Damascus.
Yes.
And what happened there?
We went to Lebanon and to Damascus in 2010. My brother and my sister had already been to Lebanon, and I had not. And they took me, and it was just prior to the Arab Spring, and then the collapse of the Arab Spring. And it just really shook me in a way of thinking, I really don't know anything about the culture that my family is tied to.
Like the students in San Antonio.
Like the students in San Antonio. And that if I really want to use the subject matter of heritage and territory and sentiment and cultural foundations, I needed to get to work. I needed to educate myself. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I did. I started getting opportunities. I got grants and a couple of awards that gave me the financing to be able to go back to the Middle East and also to go to Paris and Mexico City to look at the trajectory of migration patterns that happened adjacent to my own families and then currently. So I was using a 100-year window of history to try and understand my own background and current events and then make work about it.
Mm-hmm. So yes. Can you kind of like talk about that role?
Okay. Well, the reason I decided to actually go full board into looking at cultural associations as subject matter was I was old enough as an artist to have done most of what I had wanted to do, and I thought I have nothing to lose to turn a corner here. I have a reputation, I have the respect of my peers, I have a really good art dealer, Jim Harris, who was behind me, and I just said from now on out, I'm going to be making work that is driven by the titles of the show. I'm interested in a narrative that can come together, can coalesce in multiple forms in one place. So that was really an epiphany for me, and kind of liberating, because I just thought, really, truly, again, I have nothing to lose and everything to gain by learning more. And that's literally what I did, because as I went to each city, Beirut, Paris, Mexico City, Los Angeles, New York, and I was looking at archives. I was looking in libraries. I was trying to find links that would tell me why in the world did my family take this directive mm-hmm. and somebody else's went another way? You know, what is happening now? What we're seeing now is certainly parallel to what happened for my family, although they weren't under duress necessarily when they left. They were chasing opportunities mm-hmm. in the Americas. And that was different than some of our movements that we're seeing today. But there were enough comparisons that I thought there's a kindredness here. And also I found that what was the real sparks for me were the tiny narratives, the little behind the scenes stories, the kind of what you would call the comma in historical events mm-hmm. that for me were so fascinating, and nobody knows about this. Why don't I make work about mm-hmm. that?
So let's talk about some of those pieces, just yeah. like the flower piece and the bronze pitas in 2015 that you made those for a group
yeah.
show.
Right.
So can you talk about I love the idea of where ideas for pieces come from, and I love that you're like searching for stories, searching for narrative stories yeah. that somehow stick to you, that move you in some way. And so,
yeah,
go ahead. Bronze pitas and the flower piece.
Okay.
The flower piece is pretty awesome.
Yeah, that has its own little story. The first thing I thought of is when people think of the Middle East, what do they think of? Well, worldwide, it's the food. And what's the most obvious food piece? It's pitas. And those have been integrated into every cuisine worldwide. And so I thought no one would ever make a monument to honor a piece of bread.
Except you.
Except me, yeah. So I bronzed an actual pita bread mm. in five or six different pieces. And in my exhibition, when I would talk about the work, I passed around the bronzed pita pieces and gave someone a tactile connection that I felt was so simple, and but also so resonant. So the next opportunity was for the a show that was called Out of Sight, that was with the first, I believe it was the first Seattle Art Fair. And I got asked to do a piece that, whatever I wanted, that was sculptural, installation driven, and I had 5 weeks to come up with it. And I had happened to read that drought was a very consistent problem in sections of Syria. And, you know, one could say now that climate degradation is proving to be true for a lot of places, mm-hmm. that if the earth is not producing, you can't produce the things that are the staples in the cuisine of a place. And I learned that there had been these exoduses from regions in Syria, people going to urban centers because the crops were failing and they couldn't grow wheat. If you can't grow wheat, you can't make bread. And I knew that very few people knew about that. So, or at least it would not be on the, you know, top radar of somebody's thinking about that part of the world. So what was, again, the most obvious, ubiquitous connection to the Middle East? It's carpets, it's ornamental carpets. So I decided I was going to make an ornamental carpet out of baking flour, and that's what I did. And it was, the piece was called Impossible Monument, On My Eyes and My Head. In Arabic, when that expression means I would do anything for you. Hmm. And I just thought, that's it, you know. And I wrote a little narrative about where the story came from, why I made it, and so I had a point of departure for discussion with people, and it just has stuck in the mindset of the community of people who saw that work. I've been asked to make it again.
And that was the beginning of the Impossible Monument series.
Yes, it was.
Can you talk about another work of that series? And there are maybe 10 of them altogether or more?
I think I've done eight at
okay.
this point.
Flotsam, I really like that a lot. And so yeah. can you tell the story about Flotsam, how that happened?
Yeah. I won this award called the Stranger Genius Award, and it gave me money and some notoriety. And there was an exhibition that was happening at the Frye Art Museum that was all the past winners of the Stranger Award. And the curator at the time, Joanne, she grabbed me and said, I want you in this show. Well, I had 6 weeks to come up with something. And
this is getting to be a theme.
It's, yeah, deadline, that short-term pressure. Deal yeah. is happening okay. there. And I had also been asked to do a talk at the Arab Festival at the Seattle Center. So I had gone to the festival, and in walking around, came upon a table of Doctors Without Borders. And I started talking to the nurse who was there, and he explained to me that there were things that Doctors Without Borders does that no one would know about. And one of them was that Yemeni fishermen had come to Doctors Without Borders and asked them for their advice and their assistance in respectfully removing lost persons and their belongings in the Mediterranean. And I just was, of course, horror-struck. And also heartwarmingly struck that this organization would do that. And I was certain people didn't know that. So I did a new piece called Impossible Monument Flotsam. Flotsam is basically detritus that gets tossed overboard. And in the piece, I used buoys and a huge kind of catch that I strung up to the ceiling, and it was filled with clothing and belongings of people that might have been lost at sea. And also included in the work, which is an unusual little side note, were lemons. Lemons are used for people that don't have access necessarily to seasickness medications. If you suck on a lemon or smell a lemon, it can offset being seasick.
So can you talk just a little bit about the storyboards? Because it felt like, a departure for you, because they were very representational.
Yes,
you know?
Yes. Well, the storyboard in theater is a device where a director or the playwright or the choreographer has sections that are snapshots of part of what the ultimate story will be. And I started thinking about storyboards as a possibility and getting snapshots of what was happening in what turned out to be conflict zones. I did find myself focusing heavily on the migrations that were happening alongside and out of Syria and Lebanon, and trying to see if there was any kind of comparisons to earlier times. What might be the experience of being someone in a forced migration? And most people are walking, so the images are vistas of what someone might see as they're walking from point A to point B. They do have a kind of a weight to them because you know that someone is in duress doing this. I've probably made at this point, I don't know, 25?
So I'm interested to hear you talk about how you protect yourself when you're diving down this rabbit hole of sorrow and tragedy and cruelty.
Well, I hope all of them aren't just that. Oh,
they're like that.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. I mean,
but there is that. Certainly there is that. I think it's really important to state that this is not my story. This is an extension of my story, these pieces. And I'm well aware of the difference. So by being second generation, I can use a personal and a distance filter to think about and translate the experience of someone who is in, again, a conflict zone or a forced circumstance that they would not have chosen for themselves. And let's face it, none of us would choose to leave our homes. I mean, and I think by virtue of the fact that I know that this is a distanced assessment and choice that I'm making on what I'm using as subject matter, it gives me an out a little bit, but it also puts me in a position of really being informed about what it is mm-hmm. I've chosen to paint. And that has been because I've found other scholars and community centers and archives that have been willing to help me verify information or give me more historical background.
You know, you've always been an activist all your as long as I've known you. You've served on boards, the Artist Trust. You've hosted shows for younger artists. You've always, used your estimable skills of hospitality to further a particular cause here and there. But it seems to me like now your art is your activism.
I worry about getting stuck. I do worry about, what if I don't have any more ideas here? I mean, but I think that that's common, yeah. For most artists. I also think that I feel that the gift of being a mature artist is that you can't turn back.
I mean, you're like the multi-instrumentalist. You started out as a painter and a drawer, and you will always have that skill. And then you started doing installations, and then sculpture, and then, I mean, you've really, and then it became more politically or narrative kind of art. I want to sort of start to wrap things up a little bit, because the latest or the most recent series that you've done is called Trembling Turf. It just reminds me of a dark wall of rocks that has been just fractured with these tiny, tiny little white capillaries. Can you talk a little bit about Trembling Turf? Because I didn't see necessarily how that related to the Impossible Monuments, to the Middle Eastern themed series that you have been working on.
This series is called This Trembling Turf. There are 10 of them.
And they're big.
Yeah. They're 5 by 4 feet. I drew them specifically so that you would stand in front of them as if you were parallel to compacted earth. And I came to this series from finding a kind of dark episode while I was in Beirut, of an expansive grave that was not being verified. And that's one of the, if you are working with what would be considered real information, you have to look at not only the character of the information and the source of the information, but your own ethical concerns about how much of that information do you use. In that case, I thought, this is a really extraordinary story, but the story really is, how do we find lost cultural artifacts and events underground? So I started researching forensic anthropology and forensic archaeology, looked at both of those disciplines, and learned about the devices that they use that in essence are like sonograms. They skim the earth, and where there happens to be something that's solid, it pulses, the device pulses. And then those researchers know where to try and look. I just became captivated by how can I take this singular story and make it global. And that was my way of being able to make a series that I completely got lost in. It's one of the easiest bodies of work I've made just because it was so compelling to draw like that. And I'm really proud of that series. I think that it's one that is resonant on so many different levels, and that's where they come from. So I have been working in series. I've been doing the Impossible Monuments, the storyboards, and this Trembling Turf.
What are you going to do next?
I'm open to all of it at this point. I do feel like I'm going to finally have an opportunity to bring some of this work together in one place. I have an exhibition that will open in June at the Frye Art Museum that will focus on the Trembling Turfs.
Which is where it started, kind of, right?
And a new Impossible Monument. And then at the Whatcom Museum in Bellingham, the Light Catcher, I'm going to be given an opportunity to bring almost all of these different facets of my work together in a larger exhibition. And that's something I've been waiting for.
Victory.
And so that's a good thing. It's also scary.
So I find it really sort of like a happy ending, even though it's not over. So you decided to do what you really wanted to do, and now you have gotten all those things that you wanted by doing the thing that you really wanted to do. I mean, you're having museum shows, you're having gallery shows. So I'm curious, like, what kind of message does that send, or can you give to younger artists who are, you know, about to begin their journey?
My advice to younger artists is to trust your instincts and to be as smart as you can about the thing that you're interested in, to be as informed as possible, and to be prepared for the trajectory not being what you had anticipated, and that out of that could come opportunities to make you think and make work you wouldn't have imagined.
So how perfect is it that, you know, you're back here at the University of Washington where your art career really, I mean, officially got started,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And you're going to be joining some really illustrious artists who received this award before you did, and you, like them, will have a piece placed here in the University of Washington. So can you talk a little bit about what that piece will be and how it falls in the Marianne canon?
Yes. I've been doing this series called Thinking Drawings. The beauty of them for me is they are like my meditative music's on as loud as I want it, anything I want to make, because I use them as a segue for my ideas. So when I'm doing the thinking drawings, I am literally thinking, but I'm not thinking about necessarily what I'm making. I'm thinking about what I'm making and then all these tendrilled possibilities for other work. And I've relied on making them for years and take great pleasure in them. So I am going to be giving one of the thinking drawings to the university. I have made so many, dozens.
Huh.
Dozens, yeah.
So it's like a like a notes?
They're very abstract. They're very lyrical. They're colorful. What they show is actually my hand, if that makes sense. They show the kind of calligraphic way that I paint and the rhythm of it. And so I put a lot of history in one little image and a lot of the approach to how the piece is developed is in my hand in the work. And the one that I'm giving to the university, I loved making. And that made sense to me as a gift because that's long after this story is over and I'm gone, my hand will be in the mix, and I like that.
Do you want to say anything else? You want to make any kind of final statement?
Final statement?
Or a coda?
Well, I'm completely flattered to have been given this award. There are so many people that could have received this award, believe me.
And you are in very good company, too.
I'm in really good company. All people I admire and have had an influence on me, certainly, as a maturing artist and a not so maturing artist, as somebody who didn't know what I was doing. And so this is really lovely, and I'm honored to be included in this particular moment with this grant. Yeah. Thank you.